And I think we're on.
Here we are.
I think we're here. We're present. Yep. I'm catching it in the YouTube. There are three screens going on in front of me.
Post the link in the Slack channel for the YouTube. I actually have you friended. You know, it's supposed to have a live icon so I can just go to it, but it doesn't.
Let me pull down one of these screens.
One of the many.
Hey, we got, I think we have a viewer. I actually don't have the Slack chat. Let me pull it up. So let's get this started. I'm actually going to flip my screen here in a minute and share what I'm working on in Illustrator, because that's always fun because no one really likes to sit here and just watch you talk. Okay. I'm going to send you, and then we can go ahead and get started.
All right.
Well, we're already started. We're already live. So.
So you want me to go ahead and display my screen now, or just wait until?
Yeah, you can. Okay. And I gotta quit. I gotta drop all these windows in my. I won't be able to broadcast anything. This issue has literally killed my PC.
Oh man, I just started to, like I said, I just started to feel it with the last, with not the last page, but that, what is that, page 9 or something? I can't remember what it was, but my gosh.
Well, this it has literally killed. I have to get a new computer now. I really do. The pages are just huge. 5,000 by what? 3,000 something?
They are 3,235 by 5,000 at 600 yeah. DPI.
Yeah. And this is like, I'm still using my PC from college. So it's held up quite all right these last couple of years. Actually, it's been holding up really good. It's just whatever reason, this issue has killed it completely.
And this is one of the smaller books we'll probably do. Can you imagine that?
Yeah, exactly. This is why I need a new computer. So let's see. I am trying to pull up if we have any comments. I do not know if I'm going to be able to see it. Oh, here they go. I'm mostly keeping that window open for comments. So that'll work out. And then what I'll do here is I'll close out the rest of the stuff so we can actually get a smooth stream going, as smoothly as we can get, right?
Yeah, that's all you can do.
Right?
Technology.
Oh, gosh. I should probably flip my screen here, too. Let me go ahead and share it. Awesome. So what I have to do is get all this text.
This is probably my favorite page.
Well, the one I'm working on and the one you're working on.
No, the one you're showing right now, that's my favorite page.
Nice.
All right, and as you're doing your thing, I'm going to go ahead and mute my mic so it doesn't switch screens on you.
You can keep it running. That's completely fine.
All right.
Trying to get people like some time to filter in. You know,
yeah.
We talk about too heavy or crazy.
So for those of you who are here, how y'all doing? How you doing, Lawrence?
I think it's just Oh, we actually have somebody here, because usually I think it's just you and me.
Yeah, Lawrence is here right now. Constant Hustle Comics. I can dig it.
Oh, nice. What's going on, Lawrence? So then it's Lawrence and then you and me, because we both have the screen open in the background.
So before I joined Arclight Comics, Lawrence, I had a startup comic gig of my own. And I must have bounced around several names. At one point, I was, what did I want? It was like stand-up comics or lineage comics or something like that. Long story short, New Light Comics. And I was talking over Brent. He was like, well, we got Lighthouse, Arclight, and New Light Comics. We're all a bunch of light people, huh? I was like, yeah, that kind of makes sense. You know, so I'm going to come up with something different. So I took some time to think about it, and I landed on One Flow Comics, which is, you know, at the time I was the only person on my team of one. You know, that's where the one came on, flow, because it's everything's flowing through me, and then the comics, which was what I was working on. And I thought it was really cool. You know, it was pretty personal, and everything tied together really well, except there was one problem. One Flow is a septic thing. it's something to do with toilets and, you know, so I was just like, dang it, because I was actually liking the name. I remember going to DeviantArt, and I actually made a DeviantArt account just for One Flow Comics. And I was all excited and everything. I was like, it has something to do with toilets. So I was like, God dang it. So I just tossed the name and just went back to Bombard Comic. And then, long story short, I was very close to finishing my story. And I'm going on for a tangent right now, forgive me. But long story short, I was very close to finishing my first draft. Or I was the first story arc. And I was like, man, I really probably should get some practice on drawing my panel work. Hey, what's going on, Maru? How you doing?
Hey, Maru.
Maru, I'm sorry. Butcher that name.
It could be Morrow. She's gonna have to help us in the community on how to pronounce
Exposito. I'll go Miss Exposito. Exposito. There you go. Excuse me. So I had my first draft done. I stopped for a moment. I was like, man, I should probably take a moment to brush up on my panel work skills, because I had drawn in my entire life one comic page, and it was garbage. Complete garbage. So I went up, practiced, like, dang, this is horrible. And my panels were stiff. And the one thing to keep in mind when you're doing panel work, the one thing I've always heard is you need to be able to tell your story without any of the text on it.
Right.
I could not do that at all.
I give like an example because I just want to like piggyback on what you, hey, what's going on? Algorithm Comics. I don't remember his name. I remember Algorithm Comics, but I can't for the life of me remember.
I'm going to call him Shinobi.
Shinobi.
I'm not going to do 793 because you're the only Shinobi for me.
Let me see if I can pull in, there are a million folders on my desktop right now, and I feel like any day now this is going into like my whole desktop's going to explode because of this issue. I swear to God.
I actually like to keep my desktop almost blank. But before that piggybacks off that, long story short, my panel work needed a lot of work, so I took a couple days and went into deep thought. I was like, I'm not ready for this project. I need to develop my skills a little bit more so I can tell my story through the arts. And I was like, you know what? I think I'm going to take a step back, maybe do on, you know, some commission work. And I think I made a Facebook post about it. And then I got a message from Ed. And I was like, well, this is kind of weird. I was like, oh my gosh, what the heck is this? Because I'm thinking, you know, because maybe he's going to offer with like website design, because that's what he was doing. Because I knew he did branding and website work, you know, before. And I was like, you know, maybe he's going to help me with that. And then he was like, so we want to set up an interview. I was like, yeah, okay. Okay. So have my interview and the rest is history, y'all. don't know what came, why that was brought up, but yeah, just wanted to share that. Storytelling through comic pages. So go ahead, Ed.
Yeah, I just want to, because Miguel is so brilliant at what he does. Actually, a lot of these pages, like this one in particular, they didn't originally, I couldn't say that right, originally have any dialogue on the page. And I don't know if that helped Miguel or Miguel is just that good at communicating what's going on in every single panel. But even though it doesn't really need additional text or context on here, we put it on there anyway to kind of accent things and give it a little bit more flavor. But I mean, you even know what's going on in this page. I mean, he's running from something. He's entering a, you know, a building. Very heartfelt moment right here, as you'll see in the actual comic. Family man. You know, not they don't have much, but you can tell that they're very happy and content people. And something special is going on from this panel to this panel. But pull up another example because Miguel is just amazing. I can pull this one up because we've already shown this.
Hey, Darren, how you doing, bud?
What's going on, Darren? This is another good one. This scene. It's almost as if, like, Miguel has, like, telepathy. And he goes into my head and he pulls out exactly how I envisioned it. I don't know how he does it. He's done this throughout the many issues too, but this was another one where there wasn't any text on the dialogue or narration or anything like that on the page. But he was just able to nail the transformation scene incredibly well. And then there comes Tim with these colors that come out of nowhere. it's just yeah, I agree with you because your artist can tell a fluid story without any text on the page. Like you should be able to get the gist of what's going on. Luckily, I'm so thankful that Miguel is on our team. I told you I'm gonna have him on retainer. I don't want him working for nobody else.
And the funny thing about Miguel, I don't know if anybody in here knows this, is Miguel is from Spain. English is a second language for him, but somehow he can, I think he reads English better than he might speak it, though I've honestly never spoken to him before. Right. But he can take our script, and then shortly after he looked at our script and got back with it, it's like, all right, it's going to be this many pages. So, right. Okay. And then we went over it. Miguel, I don't know if it was Miguel that came back, or maybe it was us that discovered we needed a couple more. But the thing with Miguel is he can look at a script, and he probably visualizes it in his head of what the page is going to look like before he even powers on his tablet. But he can read the English, translate it, and do it very, very well. Very, very well.
Seamless transition from the text to the illustration and the art. So Lawrence asked, I think it was Lawrence, what we all do here. You go first. I think my hats are a lot longer and bigger of what goes on here, like what we actually do. I will give you that.
You're the Renaissance man of Arclight Comics. So my name is Tim Wozni. I'm the art director of Arclight Comics. I do production art, promotional art, and interior colors for the comics. I am a, I want to say, actually, you know what? We all wear many hats in the company. You know, I wrote a script for one of our mini issues. I'm not a writer, but I just wrote a script for it.
Whatever.
I did that. but my main focus is art production and interior colors for Arclight Comics. And my year will be up in March, March the 12th will be my 1 year anniversary with the company.
Good stuff. Yeah, Tim Any of like the major colors you all have seen, except for the mini issue number one, mini issue 2 through 6, the character art on a lot of the newer pieces, and of course this issue, Tim does. So Tim has been like the main artist on Arclight for, like you said, almost a year now. And me,
ever retiring.
Where do we start? No, I'm Ed Williams, and I am one of the original founders of Arclight Comics. I headed this up back in 2011, and I was like, we first tried this in 2011 with a much larger group of people. It was called Paradigm Studios. And that was a mess. Did not work out. Too many cooks in the kitchen, around 8 people. Nobody could ever agree to anything. Everybody argued. We fought. We fussed. Shambles. Then I was like, okay, this is not going to work out. So I said, hey, you and you, come with me. We're just going to kind of do this on the side and whatnot else. Launched the Kickstarter. Kickstarter was successful. Got the funding. And then from 2011 to 2014, team behind me, lost the team in 2014. Nobody could commit anymore. So I was all on my own. So I was like, okay, got to do something here, because it's been since 2011 and nothing is still out. What am I supposed to do? And what happened was I wrote this issue that's coming out this year, back in 2014. I think I had enough. I was just fed up with all the world building and character development. It's like, let me write the issue. Let me get this out. And then when I wrote the issue, and then, you know, it's kind of like, well, I don't know how to pay for this. No money whatsoever, because guess what? Comics cost money to produce. And so there was no money in the bank to crank out a 20-page or over 20-page issue at the time. So I was like, well, let me do mini issues. Let me like tell these one-page stories. One character per story, introduce people to the characters and get them out there. And that worked really, really well. It helped in the characters beyond the character art, and helped people get acquainted with the types of stories we were going to tell and how we were going to tell them. A lot of success with those. We're actually nearing about 2,000 downloads. Those bring in a lot of traffic for us. So I do highly recommend mini issues, but so now we're to this point. But for as far as what I do, I do a little bit of everything, actually. I have to. Where do I start, Tim? I develop our business side.
Thank God.
So I head up
some of the stuff.
So I head up the company and, give us our directives, like our outlook for 2017 is all situated and set up. I manage our brand, so the website and the logos and a lot of the character logos and the character branding and things like that, and their marketing, I head up. I almost kind of like lose myself in this spiel, because I do so much. I actually don't take into account what I do. It just has to get done. I co-host on, host the Arclight podcast. All the blogs that you've seen so far, I've written all of them, but like maybe 2. I'm the person that sends out all the emails, and I'm the person that manages all the social media accounts, and I'm the person that manages our money. And gets everything set up, gets all this together, and makes sure that the team is running effectively and efficiently, and sets people up with their assignments. And
yeah, you know what I had to do? Yeah, you want to do a hangout? Sure. That was it. That's all I had to do.
American Comics is like running an art marathon, Darren.
Now hiring interns.
He really is. Oh my goodness. Hey, what's going on, Ashton? But yeah, so that's like, you know, and then Arclight got started. It came out when I was in college. It wasn't called Arclight, but the foundation was set. Me and my best friend, it was like I was done with school. He was like, why don't we create a comic book? I was like, okay, cool. You know, I tried this before when I was little. But he was like, no, like, let's, like, if we're going to do it, we're going to do it. Like, let's, like, create, like, a company and this is that and the other. That really got me intrigued because I never heard anything like that. I always wanted to create a comic, but never, like, the company, you know? So I got started down that path, and then that's when I joined what was called the Peacekeepers back then. It was a guild for DC Universe Online. That's where I've met Tim. That's where I met Brent. For those who are familiar with Brent from the Arclight podcast, Brent is our business relations manager. And Spencer, who is newly brought onto the team. Gabby. Actually, everybody who's on the Arclight team is from the Peacekeeper Guild. Darren in the chat was also in the Peacekeepers. So we kind of formed a foundation there. And the goal, the outset of the Peacekeepers was to create iconic, new iconic original characters for the game, you know, to rival Superman and Wonder Woman and Batman. It's like, it was a huge ambitious goal because you really can't Wonder Woman, Superman, and Batman, but we were like, hey, let's try it. And when we came out, we hit the ground running. Like, it was like an explosive, immediate success on the thing. Like, we had action figures and we had videos and the things that we were able to create and the characters that came out of that guild were phenomenal. We did a lot of stuff in the Peacekeepers Guild. Hey, what's going on, Christian? We kind of graduated from the Peacekeepers after we figured out that DC Universe Online game was no longer a good fit. We tried City of Heroes. Not everybody migrated successfully over to City of Heroes. That was a debacle. And we were like, well, what do we do? You know, we built this huge universe and it cannot fit within the confines of... And the comic thing kept coming up. And we had tried, again, like I said before, several times and it never worked out. And that was the kind of like what got the ball rolling finally for Arclight. I was like, okay, again, if I'm going to do this, I'm going to do this in such a way that we're going to pay attention to not only the creative side, because we have the creative side. We have no issues with the creative side. It's the business aspect of it that I wanted to tackle that a lot of people don't seem to. Tim, I don't know why. The business side is, and when I'm talking about the business side, I'm talking about, like, I'm not talking about like a business plan and things like that. I'm talking about your vision. What is the outset? Like, what is going to come out of this comic book? What are you creating this for? Who are you creating this to? What is the overarching goal? Like, what are you working towards in the next 5, 10, 15 years with this comic? What is it setting the foundation for? What are you building up to?
You know what it could be? I think a lot of people might be intimidated by stuff like that. So if they're flying solo like I did, like I remember listening to podcasts, but before I got in the squad, and I was like, you know, we're going to cover branding, marketing, and all that stuff. That's the stuff I wanted to learn because that's the stuff that scared me the most. And I think if you're flying solo, especially if you're not willing to take the leap to go ahead and find out what it takes to get that aspect of the business side covered, then you're going to be sitting there waiting for somebody else to come on your squad to take that role for you, which is why I'm glad I am the colorist, just an artist for Arclight Comics, because when Ed and Brent go back and forth about the business side, and we actually had a nice conversation with our Lincoln Farquharson of Far Corner Studios, I think it was. And he gave us a lot of good information about the business side of comics, you know, and what it takes and stuff like that. And I'm just sitting there like, oh, my gosh. If I was still – I told you the story that I was working on my own project before. If I found out that information and I was still solo, I would have been done. I would have taken that leap. Are you kidding me? I was like, all right, that's a wrap. I'm done. Who's hiring?
But yeah, I mean, you know, that's like we figured out why we were doing this back in 2011. Like that was like a 2 or 3 month process within itself. why are we here? Are we here just to make comics? Because if that's so, we don't need to invest as much money, as much time, as much of our resources as we're planning to invest. If we're doing like a one and done type of thing, that's cool. Do it. But we don't need to continue after this. But if we're actually going to create characters and stories with purpose that are timeless, that are memorable, and can last throughout the generations, you have to set a much wider foundation and understand why you're doing what you're doing from the outset. Because I don't, you can have the greatest of characters, the greatest stories, whatever, but if those things have no direction, if you're not putting them on a path to get somewhere, to get you somewhere, it's just not going to go anywhere. And I feel like a lot of people miss out on that key element, you know? Like I said, if you're just creating it just to create it, that's fine. Have fun. It's a hobby. It's something you do on the side when you come home from work or school, whatever. But if you're serious and you really want this to become something more than just what you share with your family and friends, if you want the stage of the world to be there when you're ready to debut, you have to put in this infrastructural work. We talked about this on the podcast. Tim, there's so much stuff on the podcast. People who don't listen to the podcast missing out, Tim. Because we talked about all this. But, yep. You know, and yeah, the business side is intimidating. It really is, Darren. But actually, I love it. You have to find somebody who actually enjoys getting into the mess of all that. And is willing to learn. Let me tell you something. I'm like 4 seasons behind on Game of Thrones. I used to watch Scandal religiously and How to Get Away with Murder. I have no idea what's going on. I think it's been like a year since I've seen both. I don't do like Netflix. My time really literally consists of my day job, which is 8 to 5. And then I do Arclight stuff. So usually that makes, or rather, I usually wake up either at 4:30 or 5 o'clock in the morning, work until about 7:30, then go to work, come home, work out for a half hour. Then like from 6:30 to 10:30, 11 o'clock, it's Arclight stuff. And then wash, rinse, and repeat. No TV, no video games, no nothing. I don't do a lot of social stuff. It's a sacrifice. This that's like the word of the night. If you don't take anything else away from this broadcast, take the word sacrifice away. I have sacrificed a lot to get to this point. And I always say, ever, I heard it in a video. I can't remember the video. Don't pay attention to the result. Pay attention to the process and the sacrifices it took for that person to get there. Because it's very easy to see somebody like come out with this awesome thing. But, oh, all I got to do is create characters and things like that as awesome and I'll be good to go. No, you have to pay attention to the hours that go. Tim, I didn't work anything on Wednesday. I realized I had been putting in 18-hour days for the past couple of weeks. 18-hour days. Right.
And even in the back of my mind, I'm like, I might actually regret this, but if push comes to shove, I'll just do an all-nighter to get the last couple pages done. But there comes a point, I mean, right. when you're doing 18 hours a day, Ed, I mean, you do need time to sleep. You need that deep realm to recharge. You know, you can go all gas, but you also need to go in the body shop to make sure everything's still working right. That's what sleep right. is.
So true. Very true. And I actually do, like, on the weekend, like this weekend, I was like, okay, get everything done by like Sunday and then we're done. I am done. I'm tired.
yep.
Tired. But I'm trying to catch up with the stuff in chat.
And it's not like it's like, man, I can't wait to get this over with. I don't want to do this. This for me is a lot of fun. Mm-hmm. But there also comes a point where, you know, I can eat pizza all day, every day, but I'm going to need at least one day to rest to eat like a cheeseburger or something.
You know? Not a salad.
Not a salad. Fruit,
a cheeseburger.
I'm going to get a cheeseburger. You got to change it up a little bit. But when you're going in, and you're looking at these pages for hours in a day, like Ed said, you know, he put in 18 hours. You're in the business aspect for that amount of time. You kind of need to look away every now and then, mm-hmm. just to recharge. Because there's something I call it. There's something I brought up that's called, or I call, content fatigue, which, when you're working on something and you get to a point where you're rushing it to finish, you're in what I call the content fatigue. You just want to get it done, move on to the next thing, or to get it finished. When you get to that point, that's when you need to stop. Be it an hour, a day. I took a week off from work, okay, to do the colors for the comic pages. And I told myself every single day, I'm going to get up at 6 a.m., at least do a page, 2 pages a day. And I maintained that. There was times where I actually got 3 pages done. So, you know what? I need a break. I got to take a day. I took actually a full day of nothing. I don't even think I turned my TV on, but, you know, it's just a day of away from the comic page. And that's not to say that I don't love what I absolutely love what I'm doing, but you do need to step away for a little bit to recharge.
You do. It's very true. So I decided to turn my camera back around, kind of show.
Oh, shoot. I forgot to do that.
Lettering.
Like,
are you good? Let me light the text some more. You guys aren't supposed to read any of this.
Super secret stuff, y'all.
Right. Actually, if I just do this, that saves the day. So this is, we are lettering. I'm lettering right now, page 19. I learned so much stuff today. And that's another part of the process, too. You have to be actively learning. Don't ever just kind of settle on what you kind of know, what you learned yesterday. Mm-hmm. Learn something new. Keep it moving forward. So these are, I use Adobe Illustrator for my lettering. This is like the number one recommended industry standard program for lettering, mainly because you can do so much with it. There's so many, so much flexibility with Illustrator. So there's two balloons here. And what I have to do here is I have to link them together so they're much more like, I have an example up here. And I also have to draw the tail. So what I do is, what you're supposed to do is, in the center of the balloon, I just drew this for visual purposes, but the center of the balloon, right? Your tails should be constructed in the center. And when you construct that first point, for those of you using Illustrator, I don't know about Manga Studio or anything else that has these types of this functionality, but the tail of the balloon should always be pointing to the mouth, right? You don't want to put it on the mouth or that close to the mouth. Go about halfway. Then I curve it. It can be curved or straight. It's a personal preference. Draw the other half of the tail.
Oh my gosh.
So then I use the eyedropper tool to adopt the same styling. And then I'll get rid of this because that's no longer needed. Again, because kind of eyeball it and measure the distance from the tail to the mouth. And once I'm settled on everything, highlight everything. There's a tool set in here called the Pathfinder. Merge everything. Everything is merged. Bada bing, bada boom.
Jeez.
There we are. I've learned so much this week about lettering. Save constantly, by the way.
Manga, you can't do that with Manga Studio. All right, Manga Studio has the bubble option and they have the tail option. They're actually two separate pieces. And once you get your balloon out, or balloon, what are we calling it? I don't know. I'm indigent, y'all. Forgive me. But anyways, the bubble, the balloon, chat thing. You throw that out there. You got the text that you can put in there, and you can kind of warp it and shape it. But once you put the tail in, you can stretch it and move it, but you can't curve it.
Hmm.
You have like two or three different tail options, mm-hmm. but once they're there, that's it. You can stretch them and rotate them, but you can't curve it like you were doing there.
Yeah, so that's why Illustrator is like the best option for the most flexibility, because you can get the balloon exactly how you want it. I mean, you can come in here, it never looks the best. Let me try it out. Distort, zigzag, if you're gonna do, now, ideally I would do this before I put the tail in, because the tail is gonna adopt these same settings, but you know, the screaming balloon, you can come in here and play with those points as so, rather like so. It can get a little crazy. I prefer doing them on my own, but there are options. You can quickly go in there and do that type of lettering work on the balloons. I actually learned something really, really amazing today. No, like earlier in the week. So normally I would just come in here and drop the text, right? And it comes in as this big line. And then what I have to do is go in here and put, rather format it in the shape of the, whatchamacallit, circle, the balloon, which can take up quite a bit of time, especially if you're just starting out, because you're going to try to perfect it and want to get it right on the first try and all this other stuff. That'd be ideally, you know, what I would go with. I figured something out though, Tim.
What's that?
What I can do, instead of doing all of that, is if I copy one of these balloons here, drag it over here, so we have an empty balloon, go back into my text, copy, and then paste. What we have here is, no matter what size of the thing is, the balloon, I can now just kind of drag and it will do its own thing and keep the shape of the circle.
Oh boy, it's getting dangerous, yo.
Yeah, this saved me so much time. So much time. It was, I was appreciative of, I'm going to be the one that's not on the page as long, because I don't want to ruin like the story, you know? So I'll adjust it back to my camera. So I can actually see the text. I had some other texts that I had to edit. As being the letterer on this, and in the future, I will not be doing this. We will bring somebody on board specifically to letter. I don't like doing everything, but when your team is only, what are we down to, four now? Four, and everybody's already kind of has their assignments. I've been lettering since issue one, so I just kind of adopted the role. But you know, you wear many hats starting out. That's another thing. A lot of people don't like to wear a lot of the hats. I mean, I don't like wearing a lot of hats that I have to wear, but I have to wear them regardless of how I feel about it. Because it's not
the role of a tour guide when we were in New York City too.
What happened?
You even took on the role of a tour guide when we were in New York City. It's like, all right, guys, let's go here.
Did I?
Yeah. All right, where do we need to go?
So much.
Pop out your phone, and I'm just chilling in the background trying to keep people away from me trying to sell their stuff. But yeah.
Right.
Also, very good tour guide, Ed.
See, there we go. Tour guide is on the list of things you have to do if you want to leave something like this. But that's what I was talking about earlier. Like, vision, you know, we wanted to get to New York Comic Con. It was like, like we're just like four people at the time. We have no money. We're all broke. How do we get up there? And you have to be able to take these big goals. A lot of big goals for people are just getting the first issue out there. And then what you have to do is reverse engineer those goals. If your big goal is, okay, I've got to put out my first issue, how do you break that down into smaller steps? Because the bigger goal is overwhelming, you know? And with us for New York Comic Con, do this, but we have to treat it in bite-sized steps. So how do we get there? Well, for one, we have to get tickets because that determines if we go or not all together. And once we get tickets, then we have to secure housing and transportation because there's no point in going if we have nothing to get us there and we have no roof over our head.
Yep.
Once we secure those pieces, then we can figure out the itinerary and where we want to go. But it was no need to put the cart before the horse, do an itinerary, get transportation in housing, and we don't even have the tickets yet. So you take your big goal, say it is creating your first issue. Well, what do you need to do first? I'm going to assume off the top of my head, write your script. Okay, that's a big goal within itself. How do you write your script? How do you approach that? What's the smaller goal to that? Draft in bullet points. Girl meets boy. Boy goes to girls with the store. X, Y, and Z, you know, real small bullet points. Second draft, fill it out. Boy meets girl. Well, boy meets girl, how? What are we in? Where is the setting? Where are we at? Why are we here in the first place? Boy takes girl, whatever I said. Well, why are they going? What's the reason? What's the cause to enable that effect? Why are they moving in this direction? Bullet points. Then you keep going back and fleshing that out more and more and more. And it's going to be really sloppy at first. I don't know why. I still do this myself. But a lot of people think that when you write a script, it's perfect in your head, but it never comes out perfect when you're writing. It's actually pretty trash. Pretty doggone trash when you put it on paper. But you can't perfect what doesn't exist. I got that from Sean McCabe, Sean West. In order to clean up a mess, you have to make one first. Right? So make your mess, then proceed into cleaning it up. That makes sense to anybody.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
You just have to get in there. I remember when I wrote this, I was frustrated, pissed off. I was like, okay, let me just kind of take a step back here. I got off the computer, laid across my bed with a notepad and a pencil or pen. And I just kind of wrote what I just explained pretty much from start to finish, what the story was, and it was bad. I did after that, I typed it up exact word from word, mistakes and all, then got a red pen like the teachers used to do.
Oh boy.
Right. Printed it out and laid across the bed again. And then with that red pen went over the script with a whole bunch of notes and then rewrote it again on the computer. And then I print that one out, take the red pen again, wrote a whole bunch of notes and revised some things. I kept doing that process until I got comfortable enough with saying, okay, this is actually a really good first draft. Let me get it in front of people who actually will critique it. So I had my friends come in, Jess and Chris, and I had one of my best friends come in, Terrell, and a couple other people. And they were like, you know, this is good. This doesn't make sense. That doesn't make sense. You know, this, that, the other. And you go through that period of refinement with your script. It's not going to happen overnight. It's not going to happen in a day. Not going to get there in a week. But the point is that you keep doing and you keep showing up and you keep trying and you just keep revisiting until, and even still, the script's not going to be perfect, even when you're done. I mean, I'm still coming in here and changing some of the dialogue up and adding things. I really need to stop. That's another one of the bad things about wearing so many hats. When you're the editor and the letterer and the writer, and you have all this in front of you, so you keep tweaking things, and I'm done after, like, tonight. But, you know, it's never going to be 100%. You can hit your 90% because 100% is just not ideal. I don't think anybody hits their 100%. Nothing's ever perfect, ever. But if you can hit your 90%, get this from Sean McCabe as well. I trust me, your 90%, if you really put in a lot of hustle and a lot of work behind what you're working on, your 90% is going to be better than somebody else's, what they consider 100%.
Mm-hmm.
Guarantee it.
Yep.
Every single time. I mean, there's people who put in 60%, maybe 70%, who blow completely like my 90% out the water. You know, they can stop where I'm at 90, they're at 70 and still got like trying to get to the other 90, you know, the rest of the 90, they can stop there and completely blow my stuff out the water. So go for your 90%. Try your best, hit your 90% and keep it moving. Don't ever sit there and try. So we actually almost got into that mindset of perfection. Earlier this week, it was like, you know what? We're not going to do that to ourselves. We put in a lot of work. We put in a lot of time. Look the way that they're looking and have things read the way that they're reading with this issue. And to nitpick it and overdo it on the details, it's just not necessary. I just don't want to get into that. I don't know about you, Tim.
No. You know, maybe when I first started coloring the comic book, yeah. Like, there's a few pages that I wanted to just go ham on. Mm-hmm. But that's another thing about keeping it consistent. You know, it's kind of visually unappealing to be over-detailed, especially if the beginning of the book is not the same.
Right.
So if you have, there are actual people in DC Comics and Marvel Comics who are paid to do what I call it's color washing. Okay, what you do is they'll put on basic flat colors, no tones, no shades, and then they'll take a color burn pen or brush, and then they'll burn in their details, and that's it. So at the end of it, it looks like it almost looks like a color flats with added noise to it, and then the opacity just brought down. And the artist, I'm sure Darren does art, might know what I'm talking about, or any other artist in the room. You know, when you add noise to it, it kind of gives it a grainy look. There are colorists being paid to do that with Marvel and DC Comics. I just looked at a page from Thor that had that. Now, for me, I like values. I like glowy doodahs. I like secondary, third lighting. I like rim lighting. I like everything under the sun. You know, Ed does too. Believe me. Rim lighting everywhere. So I like my details to come out into the colors. So if, for instance, if I'm doing, we'll call it cell shading, okay, three values, base tone, dark tone, light tone, and that's it. Move on to the next page. Do the second page, cell shade. Neutral tone or the base tone, the dark tone, and the light tone. Next page. Third page, I get detail heavy with it. We're going to shake it up. I'm going to add 5 to 6 different values, throw rim lighting in there and everything else. I'm going to throw a bucket of paint at this page. And then the next page, I'm going to go back to that 3-layer cell shading. You see, consistency throughout the entire book. Okay, I could go very, very detail heavy if I wanted to. And there are a couple of pages where I go a little bit more with the lighting, but it also depends on what the scene is. Excuse me. There is a particular scene in the book where there's cops, you know, the headlights over a police cruiser has the red light and the blue light, and they spin around and beep, beep, and boop, boop, and all that stuff. That's causing a light source. So I have to add that to the page. That's another light source. Then you have a lamp from the street. That's another light source that's hitting our figures. The page will dictate the amount of details you want. The artist that does the page is going to set that ground for you. The setting he does the inks with is going to dictate how many light sources are on that particular page. So if you got a character that's walking in the moonlight and that's it, walking through the woods in the moonlight, the light source is the moon. Okay, you're going to have very little values. Now you throw, okay, you surround him with a whole bunch of fireflies, right? Now you got the moon and you got the fireflies. Campfire. Perfect example. Moonlight and a campfire. That's perfect grounds for rim lighting right there. I'm going so technical right here. I hope it's not going over everybody's head. But to bring it home, okay, you can go as detail heavy as you want to, but you have to keep it consistent throughout the book. I can go back to some of the pages I just did and rework them, but why? Because I'm not going to do that, for one, because chasing perfection is not possible. It is a goal that you set for yourself. Chasing perfection is a goal. It's not something you can attain. So going back and reworking these pages, I'm going to put so many hours into these pages, it's going to be pointless. Okay. Right. And gosh, I can go on and on and on. So when I finish a page, okay, and Ed, Brent, Spencer, and the team, they have a suggestion for the page itself. You know, why don't you go ahead and add more lighting here? Now, feedback is going to elevate everything. Okay, everything. At the same time, you also need to kind of decide what feedback best fits the particular page. So when I'm doing, okay, this page right here, the time of day is... sun's about to rise, or the sun is rising. Okay, and Ed's like, all right, I'm this monster. I want some rim lighting. So, yeah, I can do that, Ed. The sun's coming up. Brent comes along. Tim, I want some glow effects in his skin right here. You know, put some cool glow effects up in his head, his dome. I can do that, Brent. Give me a few moments. You know, Spencer comes along. Tim, why don't you go ahead and put some shading inside the mouth? I can do that, Spencer. You know, and someone suggests this is just completely off the cuff. None of this, some of it actually happened. But when someone says something like, Tim, you're missing the rim lighting on this panel right here. Say, well, it's not the focus of the particular panel. You know, the focus of the panel, the main focus of this particular panel with the hammer right here is the hammer. So you don't want to bury it in a whole bunch of lighting and cover any details we want to do, because eventually I'm going to be going into, in adding some of the line work with this particular character, bringing it into the hammer. So I don't want to hide that with a lot of lighting. And that's another thing with Miguel's work. When I first started coloring these pages, because the very first style of coloring I ever took on was cel shading, and I was a huge Dragon Ball fan, so a lot of my fan art was Goku, Vegeta, and Piccolo, and all them guys. And of course, that coloring style went along with it. So, based on my experience, I needed, like if you look at Jack Kirby's art or Jim Lee's art, it's a lot of heavy inks. For cel shading, I want it very open. I don't want any details or any light source defined into the art itself. Hold on. So I don't want any of the light source defined within the art itself. So I was actually a little bit worried about that when we first started the comic book page, or the comic book, coloring the comic book pages. So I approached Miguel. I said, hey, can you pull back the inks a little bit? Because we're going to go with cel shading for the book. And he gave back, and as I'm doing page by page, you know, I'm actually finding that I can use his heavy inks as another layer of depth, another layer of shading. So actually, it's kind of funny because I went from, you know, wanting almost nothing but bland line art, and there's nothing about Miguel's art at all that's bland, let me tell you, but I wanted him to kind of pull back those heavy inks so I could lay down and define the light source through the colors. But later on, what ended up happening was I found that not only could I use them, but I almost needed them, you know, as another value layer. So I ended up learning that, hey, I can actually use these. And the style that I'm developing for these pages itself is not something that I've come up with myself. It's something, it's cel shading, but it's kind of taken to a different level. So what I'm doing is, let me go ahead and share this. All right, so what I actually do is, like I said, basic cel shading. Cel shading is popular for animation and stuff like that, because when they do animation, The traditional sense, they don't necessarily want to go back in and add a whole bunch of values, because the more values you add, the more values you have to consistently keep within a scene, right? So that's your neutral tone, your dark tone, and your light tone. That's cell shading. So we actually decided to go with that for our book. So what I have here is, if you look here, excuse me, you have a neutral tone, which is right here. You have your dark tone and your lighter tones, but it's broken up. Excuse me. Sorry, guys. Sorry, I'm a little bit ill. So you got your cell tones right here, but I like to break it up using a style of inking that I use. So when I go to color Miguel's pages, I color them the same way I would ink a piece of artwork. So I have hash lines or hashes, cross hatching and stuff like that. And then I'll take it a step further, because I can never just end with three values. I have to take it further. But that's not to say that I'm killing the page either, because like I said, this is the sun's rising right here, right? So now we can go ahead and come in. Okay, I'm going to do this real quick.
This is the SmackDown page.
This is the SmackDown. This is the Smash page.
Awesome. Look at that. That, like, the way Miguel rendered that, it's like, I don't know.
Gorgeous.
He's like, every other page, like, he gradually comes to see his, like, his evolution on his drawing. Like, these last three pages he sent us, completely out of this world. I don't know where that came from.
All right, so the light source is established at the time of day. Now I got my tones. Now what I'm going to do is I'll go in and add the other light source, which is the time of day. As you can see, it kind of, it just adds another value. It adds a light source, and it just elevates the entire page. And then, of course, I'll go through all this, because this right here, this is rim lighting. When Miguel does a, I don't know how to word this, zoom in right here. You see the heavy inks right here on the side of the monster's face, okay? And it's broken out on the right side with a open area, and then the left side right here is going into details. Miguel is telling me, you know, in my ear, hey, Tim, go ahead and put some rim lighting right here, because Ed wants some rim lighting. I hear you, Miguel. I know he does. Give me a second. There you go, bud. So actually, so it's raising and oops. So what I would do, I just lost my color, but hopefully you guys get the idea. You'd go in with a very heavy, sharp tone. It'll break everything away. It'll set up your time of day, give shape to the figure, give more depth to the page, and add character to the panel. So it's elevating the panel itself. Now, if I were to go in and start going very ham on these pages, which is why I'm glad we decided not to do paintings, because at the same time, Ed is going to come up behind me and add dialogue, narration boxes. Why would I spend, let's see, how long did it take? About 8 hours for a single, I'm going to cough again. Hold on.
Yeah, digital painting for the mini issues was not the best idea.
No, it was not.
Found this style a long time ago, Tim. At the beginning of the doggone year, we would have found it much more appropriate to do self-shading paints for the mini issues, because what ended up happening was, even though we would conclude 2 weeks prior to the issue having to come out, it would still take an enormous amount of time to get it all rendered, you know? Mm-hmm. It's just way too long of a process. You only should do like digital inks. Now I understand why I don't do it in the industry, because there nothing would ever come out on time. Mm-hmm. You should only really do that stuff for like marketing collateral. Marketing collateral, I'm talking about character art and promotional art and things like that for digital paints. Cover art and thing, you know, it's like a one-time thing. It shouldn't be like a repetitive style used in sequential art, unless you have the time, a year just coloring.
Now, if you look at Alex Ross's art, it's a completely different end of the spectrum.
Right.
The thing that is, it's adding a gravitas to the page itself, but it's not an artist doing art or in a separate person doing the colors. It is Alex Ross painting the pages with, you know, with his ideals and designs in mind and how the page is going to flow and then how much details, the time of day and all that stuff. All of that goes in to your pages. Every last bit of it. And it has to follow through throughout the book. So the first, I would say, maybe 6 to 7 pages is we're seeing a few of our characters out in the wilderness. And they are battling, and the time of day is sunrise, but the sun is not actually peaked yet. Or it hasn't actually broken the horizon yet. So over those pages, I had to, before I moved on to the next page, I had to pull colors from the previous page and then elevate them slightly, because as these pages evolve, when the book is released, pay attention to the time of day, because as the pages go on, the backdrop in the horizon, the skyline, the sky tone itself is actually getting brighter and brighter, because we're telling a sub story of what time of day it is and stuff like that. If I had more time, I would actually go back into the later pages and add precipitation like snow and stuff like that. But the thing about snow, that's another thing. You want to talk about going detail heavy. If you add snow, okay, of course you can just white dots all over the place and call it snow. However, someone like me and someone like Darren, we're going to go back to the page and we're going to add the snowfall. We're going to add snow collecting on top of cars. We're going to have wet spots. We're going to have reflective light because there's wet surfaces on the streets. Mm-hmm. You know, we might put some crystal looking salt on the floor. We're going to tell the story of what time of day it is. It's a lot of thought that.
Yeah, I think scope is a good thing to bring into the picture now, because you may want to do everything under the sky, but do you have the time and the resources to do everything under the sky?
There is a deadline, you know? It's not just, whenever I'm finished, Dad, I'm finished.
Right. You know, unless you don't have like a promise attached to the comic, like we're going to get it out at this date, by all means, have a ball. Hand paint every single snowflake on your own. Every unique, you know, all of them be unique designs. But if not, you got to kind of look at it like that. You know, do we have the resources or the time or the energy to follow through with yet another layer on top of what we've already done? Because I tell you right now, even though this is fun, I love what we do. But at the same time, it can get really, I don't want to say stressful, but I guess stressful is the word I'm going to use, because I can't think of
anything. I'd say heavy. I'd say it can get pretty heavy.
Heavy. Yeah, heavy. Like, I mean, like anything. I mean, anything you love, is there's going to be that point where it all comes to a head and everything collides all at once, and when that, especially when you have deadlines attached to things. But it's very important. Some might want us to talk about the mini-issue process and this process. The prequel issue was written before the mini issue, so that was a completely different process. But the mini issue process, how we went about that was after issue one with Bolt, I had Brent came on at the tail end of mini issue one. So there wasn't that much collaboration with there. And then I had already wrote mini issue number two, so there wasn't that much collaboration there either. At the time, I had brought Neff and Tim in. Few words to say, but it wasn't like collaboration. And then mini issue three, Go Girl, the bullying situation, that's where we really kind of defined how we would collaborate and put the stories together as a team. Because as I believe it's done in the industry, Darren, you can check me on this because he's actually worked in the industry before. You have one writer, one artist, one letterer, colorer, you know, sometimes the roles double up or triple up or whatever have you. One person writes the story, then it gets passed on down the line, right? The way I heard it from an artist currently working at Marvel, you know, when he gets, or rather when he draws and finishes the interior pages, they don't actually even want him talking to the colorist.
That's so weird.
At all. It is weird. So weird. They do not want you talking to each other. So it's like, wow, like everybody's that closed off from one person to the next down the line. So I'm a fan of Pixar, big fan, huge. So I've always wanted to work at Pixar. That didn't work. That's another story for another day. But I've studied Pixar and I've read their books and everything else. And I really felt that adopting their collaboration style, we could try that here with Arclight since we were so small and things were still so very new. So what we do is, and we'll be doing this again as Wave 2 mini issues come out 2017. We'll all hop on Skype or Google Hangouts or whatever. And we'll kind of say, you know, well, what character do we want to play with this time? For mini issue 3, that was Go Girl. It was like, you know, we don't know much about Go Girl. The design is cool, but who is she? I was like, okay, let's roll with Go Girl. And then we kind of talk about how do we want to see this character play out? What do we need to show the audience? You know, her personality, her powers, a combination of both. This one page. And we sat around, pitched some ideas, and then the subject of bullying came up. And a lot of times we will pitch different topics and subjects. In issue 1, it was, you know, Black America and police brutality. In issue 2, it was the political climate with Donald Trump and things like that. So 3, it was bullying. 4, it was a hidden message. It was more humorous. And then 5 and 6, I can't go into that right now because I'm losing my thoughts. But so we pick a topic and we kind of form a story around that topic. And we'll sit around all on Skype and we'll just pitch back and forth. Well, what if Go Girl was at the mall and the girls were picking on her at the mall? And, you know, but then, well, if Go Girl's at the mall signing autographs, why would these girls openly bully her? Knowing she's right there and she's a superhero. And so it's an opportunity for everybody's ideas and build off of, you know, ideas and throw, I don't want to say bad ideas, but the ideas that don't work for that situation or story out. And we catch a whole lot of holes in our stories doing it this way, just coming together and all kind of sitting around the table. And then what we do is we'll get down to like maybe the best ideas in what we call, our storyboarding phase. We're just kind of sitting around pitching concepts. And then our story engineering phase is when we actually go into Google Docs and we'll start typing things up. Where is this going to take place at? Well, let's make it in an alleyway or at a bus stop at the end of the day at school. You know, that's where a lot of kids tend to get bullied at the end of the day at school, you know, when teachers aren't around, whatnot else. And then we'll write the script together. Like one person is usually in the Google Doc typing while the rest of us are pitching back and forth still. And then we'll have that on the first, you know, usually try to get it done in the first meeting, storyboard and story engineering. And then we'll come back and revisit it. Just kind of look at it one more time. For issue 3, mainly, that one got a lot of benefit because Brent is a, help me out, Tim. Studying to be
a psychologist,
and he deals with a lot of behaviors and addictions and has been, you know, therapy centers and things like that. And a lot of the dialogue was about suicide and things like that. And, you know, we're not accustomed to how those sessions go on and how they develop. And we were putting things in there that we thought sound appropriate, and Brent would come in and be like, that's actually not the way it would go. That's actually not appropriate for her to say to somebody going through this. That would actually enable them to go through with the actual suicide. And he kind of just kind of took it from there with Go Girl's dialogue. But I think my bigger vision with that is I've always wanted to create a company where people from all walks of life, no matter your race, ethnicity, gender, sexuality, religion, whatever background you come from, we all gather around the table and everybody brings their cultural experiences, their walks of life, their lifestyles, and everything else in between to that table. And at that table is where you see the vision of storytelling possibilities. Because when we're all one thing, if we were just all black or all white, all Christian or whatever, you get one perspective and one narrative. That's what the industry's kind of been suffering from a very long time. You know, this whole diversity thing. When you have all one thing writing, trying to write diversity into all these stories, you get the same kind of flavor of diversity no matter what. But in a, I'm not saying that somebody of a different race or gender can't write whatever, but when you pull in a black man, when you pull in two white guys, when you pull in women, when you pull in somebody who's gay, when you pull in somebody who's Christian, when you pull in somebody who's Buddhist, Samoan, whatever, you get those authentic nuances that you wouldn't get outside of your own perspective and understanding.
Well, you know, so much experiences from that too.
Right. And that's kind of like my overarching vision for how we collaborate. I wanted that collection, that pool of cultural experiences and lifestyles and everything else in between at the table. So when we write stories with characters that are women, that are people of color, that are LGBTQ, that are whatever, we have a great pool of experience and authenticity sitting around at the table, like the situation with Go Girl and Brent, knowing what goes on in those sessions to really make that story pop. And that's actually one of our most downloaded issues to date, that and even issue one. You know, he showed a couple of his classmates that issue and some of his professors that issue, and the response we've gotten back from it has been phenomenal. We actually, you know, somebody had told us that we needed to link up with some people to get it printed and get it in like facility, as it really could help somebody
with
the situation. So when you do it like that, when you're just not, and you get that diversity, like true diversity, I don't like saying it because it's such a hot topic, like buzzword and issue right now. But when you get that true diversity around your writing table, and I always say everybody's a storyteller at Arclight. Everybody. I stick by that all the time because it's true. If all of us are storytellers. I don't care if you are doing business relations like Brent or just, you know, on colors like Tim. Tim wrote many issues 5 and 6. These finished. We got to put some ideas on the table. Tim was like, okay, I got something. Mister, I'm not a storyteller. And I'm like, Tim, where the heck did this come from? But it just, it goes to show, if you, this is another important thing people miss out on, your culture. You have to pay attention to the type of culture you're building. If your culture is inviting, like Arclight, I say again all the time, everybody's a storyteller. If that is the cultural mindset, people feel comfortable with pitching their ideas to tell stories. If your culture is dead set on setting it up as the industry sets it up, saying that only the storyteller or only the writer can write, only the artist can draw, only the colorist can colorist, that's the lane everybody's going to be in. But if you open that up, if your culture is accepting to different ideas and allows people to join in on those ideation and conceptualization sessions, you get a broader pool of people able to tell stories. And stories are, I mean, come on. At the core of our humanity, storytelling is there. Mm-hmm. Everybody's able to tell a story. It's just some of us, you know, have more experience in it than others. You know, everybody has a starting point. You know, your storytelling may be, it may just be as basic as, I went to the store, got some cheese, and I came home. The end.
That's a great story.
And then others will write a novel on how they went on this epic adventure to get, they're just throwing in some cheese, and they fell into the cheese rack, and then they found some magical fantasy land behind the cheese rack. You know what I'm saying? It's different. But everybody is a storyteller at the heart of their, you know, humanity. And I think we really do a good job at cultivating that type of culture, not only within Arclight, but our community as well. For those who don't know, we have a community that's dedicated to indie comic creators. .com/community. You can actually sign up. Don't pay attention to the price right now. Just kind of sign up, fill out the application and whatnot. But we do a whole lot of this in there as well. You know, we have artists and people who don't, namely, do a lot of storytelling, but you get in there and you get accustomed to our culture and you see us in there telling stories and talking about the stories and how we're open to that. It starts having an effect on the community we created as well, you know. Chris, actually, if you, I'll just say it right now, you can go to, I'll post the link because you can pre-order today. I'll post the link up. I had it up. I did not copy and paste it like an idiot. But, you know, I love doing this, though. And that's another important thing. If you're going to do your own studio, you have to love being in love with the infrastructural and cultural building aspect of it. That's very important. You have to have some ebb and flow to how you work. Mm-hmm. Your people have to have processes and systems. I mean, I'm still working on this now. I don't have, we're not perfect by far.
So we could be 50 years in and still learning.
Right. But there have to be established processes and systems in place. You know, when we bring on board somebody, onboard, well, they have to be invited into the Slack. They have to get acquainted to the Slack. Then they have to be acquainted to all our other programs and applications that we use to run Arclight. Then I have like job description. I have like little sheets, one pager sheets of your job description and your title, what all that means and what I expect of you. And, you know, the 30-day check-in and the 60-day check-in as you're interning during that process to see how you fit into the culture of Arclight. And then once you're, once you graduated from your internship, you get business cards and, you know, X, Y, and Z. And it's a process. It's a work in process, but what you have to set up.
Mm-hmm. It's like, how bad do you want it?
Right. I'm not doing any lettering. I've just been talking like it's
I actually, I just saved my document because I
goodness gracious.
It's all right.
Not some of this stuff. But yeah, it's again, sacrifice is the key word for tonight. You have to be willing to sacrifice your time, a lot of your time, if you want to do something like this. You know, it took me years to get up to this point. I remember back in 2011, I actually saw this, Tim. Like, we're not nowhere near where my vision is at, but I saw us getting to at least this point. First issue out with an audience. Characters, phenomenal characters, great stories, and everything else in between.
This starts with a vision, but,
right?
And then it gets put in motion by drive,
right? Exactly. And so, I mean, hell, some days I don't feel like doing this. I do want to take like 3 months off and be like, okay, I'm just tired. I'm going to sit this out for a quarter and be done with it. But you still got to show up. Every single day. There were days, I mean, when I had my, I had hyperthyroidism and it was really, really bad and I could hardly walk, but I still pulled myself out of that bed every day, came in this room, sat down and did work for Arclight, recording podcasts, writing, doing whatever I needed to do for that day to get something done to move us closer to those goals. There's, I mean, there's been times where I've had, like, you know, like really bad stomach viruses and things like that. Still, laying in the bed, even if it was just drawing or taking notes on something, you know, just to do work. I do rest. People, they like to call me a robot.
Robot.
I don't know why.
That doesn't slow your powers down.
Right. But I just want to kind of communicate, you know, what it takes. But I don't think a lot of the scope of that, you know, it's so much more than stories and characters and getting that first issue out. It's a whole lot of groundwork that has to be. I hope I'm not scaring anybody. If I'm scaring you, let me know in the chat. But, you know, this story in particular, issue zero, The Passing, again, this comes out of the why. But back in 2011, when we first started, we wanted to really create stories that were going to help people, that inspired people, that things that challenged our biases and our certain opinions of different people or whatever the subject or topic was of that day, to kind of have us take a look in the mirror at ourselves and question ourselves and see if we are wrong about the way that we think about things. And there's pulling in the reality of our world. A lot of people like to say, oh, don't put social issues in comics and things like that, not understanding that the history of comics are rooted in social issues. I don't understand that, Tim. I understand people say, don't put social issues in comics. Do you not understand what this genre has done between it and society? But whatever, that's another topic for a different day.
Green Lantern and Green Arrow,
Tonic.
The earlier comics, that's all they were about. And I don't remember the artist's name, but oh my gosh. That
iconic.
Speedy, doing the drugs.
Iconic.
That's what they iconic. Tackled. You know, a black guy comes up to Green Lantern. I've seen you save purple skins, green skins, and blah, blah skins, but what have you done for the black skins? Coming back to humanity, what have you done for the humanity? What about the people? You know, having a voice in comics has started right there in Action Comics number one. Jerry Siegel and Joe Shuster, I don't remember who it was, but one of their fathers had actually passed away. And the reason why Superman is very strong is because of that experience from him. They're two Jewish guys, you know, so you got this guy from another planet, an outsider, you know, the experience of segregation embodied into what is one of the most iconic heroes, arguably, of all time. I mean, he started this whole thing, and it started on that ideology. So for someone to say, you can't do that, I mean, turn the volume down a little bit. You know, we're going to raise it up a little bit. No, but, you know, when someone tells you to kind of pull back a little bit, it's almost like they're telling you that you're doing the right thing. Okay, you're going in a direction that they might be too afraid to explore. Mm-hmm. If now you can differentiate if someone's giving you proper feedback or if they're trying to coach you in a direction that they do not want you to go because that's what they're trying to do. So right. Just take the time to, right. if you have a story to tell, tell your story.
Right.
You know, if there's a voice that, if there's something you want to put out in front of people, so your opinion and your right to free speech, whether it's vocally projected or projected through your artwork or whatever, you have that right. Use it. Mm-hmm. That's all I got to say because I'm starting to lose my voice.
No, you're good. I got you. I'll
sorry take about that.
That's on your heart. This is your comic. These are your characters, these are your stories. Do what you feel is best, no matter how many people you want to piss off. You know? And like I was saying, you know, in order to tell those types of stories, to heal, to inspire, to teach, we had to fold in the realities of our world. So we had me being a black man, for anybody who can't tell, who can't see. You know, my reality, my perspective of the world is different from Tim's. It's different from Brent's. It's different from Spencer. It's different from Gabby's, you know? So The reality of my world involves the culture of my people, the climate of African Americans versus against police brutality. You know, that's where Mini Issue One came out, and the struggles of that. So, you know, a lot of our characters, I think the majority of them are actually Black, but a lot of them have adopted, or rather come from that same experience. I always said, you know, for Black characters or characters who are of color, with all the things that we deal with on a regular basis as just people, what on earth would call you to run out to outer space first and not deal with the really bad situations and circumstances we go through on a daily basis? You know, I know Marvel doesn't tend to travel in that lane with their characters, Black Panther and Luke Cage and Falcon, and same with DC. But I said, but with my characters, stories, I can't imagine. If I were to actually adopt Earth Control tomorrow, the first thing I would not do is run out to space and fight space aliens. I would, well, first of all, if I control the Earth, I don't necessarily know what I would do. But that wouldn't be one of the things. But, you know, I would, given the climate of my reality and what my people are facing right now, there and try to help. This would be my main concern. And Tim's reality may be different, where if he were to adopt superpowers, by the way, I remember telling Gabby the same thing. If you have, or rather, if your character has a feminist agenda, if you view the world as a feminist and that's your perspective and you really want to like and do what you want to do, you have that freedom and you have that right to take us through that perspective with the characters that you create, you know? Because oftentimes, comics are a great way just to kind of, I mean, even though we're folding in reality and social issues, it's still escapism. It's a different brand of escapism, but it's still escapism. People running around with super speed and flying around. We don't do that in real life, you know? But it still gives you kind of check out, step back from Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and all the other craziness in the comment section, and go about understanding the issues in a different way. And I think one of the most important things we do in this issue is we don't play it to one side. I am very cognizant of that. I'm very cognizant of making sure that I don't develop a narrative, an anti-police, because I'm not anti-police whatsoever. I'm against police brutality, corrupt cops, you know. In this story, and even in Mini Issue One, we have the perspective where there were police officers in there that didn't want to go through, that were trying to stop the other officers from shooting that kid. You know, same thing in here. Not all cops are the same.
Human nature doesn't go away when you put on a badge. But the human is still there.
Right. I mean, I think that's a great way to actually like pitch things.
Yeah.
Humanity doesn't go away when you put on the cape or when you adopt superpowers. I always say, if you were able to phase through the wall, woke up and able to phase through the wall tomorrow, if you were struggling financially, personally me, I might actually dip into the bank overnight and get me and wipe out all my debts and all these loans and whatnot out and be clear, you know? But that's like a survive. If you're given those opportunities, as we as people, we're people first. Nobody's going to automatically just run out there and put on a cape and start saving the day. There's a process to this, you know? And actually, the entire world is going to flip itself on its head. This is like the Arclight universe we're talking about now. You know, if all of a sudden we woke up tomorrow, everybody had powers, what do you think the state of this world would be? Schools are phasing through walls and teleporting through walls, and jails aren't strong enough anymore to hold people back, and you have all kinds of stuff. Our first responders are no longer enough. Society would fall apart. It's like a different version of The Walking Dead almost, you know?
Yep.
And that's the direction we decided to go in, is to tell what would actually happen and what is the sacrifice and cost of being a hero in such a world. where humanity is always going to come first. And you have to, on a daily basis, strive to not fall below a certain threshold and cross a certain line, because there's no coming back from that. But at the same time, who do you call a villain and who do you call a hero? Because the mother who's homeless on the street all of a sudden adopts, I don't know, invisibility or telekinesis or something and uses those powers to protect her children. I mean, you know, she's stealing from the grocery store or whatever, but she's doing it out of the perspective that she has to feed her children. Mm-hmm. Now she has a way to actually feed her children. Do we call her a villain? Do we call her a bad person? Is she a bad person for doing what she's doing? Versus somebody who's using their powers maybe for the good, but they're doing it in a way and they're monetizing off of it. They're doing it only because they can, this is the way they're getting rich. This is the way for all the brands to buy in. You're only heroing for the benefit of the money. Do we call that person a hero, even though they are saving people? You know, I think we got deep from it.
Mm-hmm. You went in, man.
That was not intended, but that's what our universe is based on. Use it for a podcast episode, leave you me. But that's what the universe, our universe is based in. And again, this goes back to vision and why, because if you don't foundation on something, you don't have a direction to go in and get to a point like that. You have to define and your characters and your stories in the context of why, you know? Exactly, Darren. Find a why behind everything. How do you tackle social issues without serving it down the reader's throats? By not making it the only thing you talk about.
Yeah. You break it up. Like, right. Mini issue one came out, you know, the one bad cop. And you also don't go so hard on it either. Okay, it wasn't one cop, and then another cop comes up and does the exact same thing. And then another cop comes up, throws the kid to the ground, and what have you. You have one cop, and you have two other police officers who are of the right mind. You know, you don't embellish your point, is what I'm trying to say. And then, like Ed said, you also break it up. With Riot's mini issue, you know, we made it comical. But it's not just one of those things where it's meant to just get a laugh. You know, at the base of it, there is a story there. You know, you should probably check how deep the water is before you dive head first. So if you have a voice, if you have a topic you'd like to touch on, and if you don't want to kind of shove it down their throats a bit, then kind of dilute it a little bit. Like I said, like with Bolt's mini issue, it's not one cop. It's then another cop coming behind him and just portraying the image that all cops are bad. You know, with mm-hmm. Bolt, it was one cop, and then there was two other officers with him, you know, that was, you know, help the kid up and stuff like that. So to do that, you just don't go all ham, you know, you full throttle into that social issue or that opinion you might have to convey mm-hmm. to your readers or your fan base, you know, kind of pull back the reins on it a little bit. Even do it in subtext. Mm-hmm. Like the subtext for Riot's mini issue was check how deep the water is. At the face of it, though, was just a funny story of a dude who just grabbed the wrong cat, you know. Mm-hmm. You know, you can go on a subtextual or a sub layer for the story. You can do that as well. Mm-hmm. That's all I got. I'm about to cough again.
No, you hit the nail on the head. Again, you don't beat people over the head with it, and you don't, like Tim said, embellish it. And you make sure that you have, or rather, respecting the other opinion as well. Because I would only say, you know, police brutality is bad, but if the narrative was that all cops are bad, then I'm not doing my job as a writer. I'm not handling my responsibilities responsibly at all. We have the social issue, police brutality, but we also highlight the perspective that not all cops are bad, that there are good cops out there. So you don't, you know, make it so heavy. And I mean, social issues don't come up all the time in conversation as people. We do talk about other things. I think that's one of the important things too, because in this story, it's, I think like the third quarter of it is only social issues, I think. I don't know. I should know, but there's a lot of things going on in my head right now. We dance around it. You use different approaches to tackle it, how you want to tackle it, but you also have to be mindful to not just stick it to people. I think mini issue number two is one of the examples I can give you, just sticking it to people. I think if I can go back and redo that issue, we would. That's one of like at least
all around
downloaded issues. Yeah.
Even to the colors.
yeah, it was just too on the nose. Too on the nose with the Trump thing and everything else. We go back and redo that one. But Brax has another mini issue coming out next year to kind of make up for that. But again, you just don't hit people over the head with it. And shove your opinion down people's throats. Because some of these characters, even though they're like different extensions of me, they have different perspectives and viewpoints than I do. Tremor is a Republican. Brax is a Republican. Bolt's a Democrat. And Go Girl's a Democrat. And Riot's just like, whatever, you know. you know, whoever is the best one for the job, I'll just go ahead and, you know, change my political party, whatever. But you know, they have different viewpoints, and I have Braxton is more black and white in how she views the world. You know, it's either this or that. And Tremor has a more gray area where he operates in. You know, I mean, people are bad, but they can be good at the same time. Bolt is more very emotionally driven, angry child, actually. You'll see why in future issues and things like that. But and then you have Go Girl, who is just – Tim, how do we describe Go Girl?
Go Girl is very in the moment. I don't think she's going to pop on CNN. Probably not even the Weather Channel.
Right.
No, all the information she'll ever need is right there in her phone.
Right.
That's go.
Perfect. Right. Very in the moment. Very, you know, here, there, 1 second she's on this, and then the next second she's on that. And then Riot is just like you're all around for a guy. Let's just go have fun. I don't care about any responsibilities that I have. Let's just go have fun, you know? And a lot of their viewpoints and perspectives on different issues, I don't necessarily agree with, but that's not your job as a writer to make all your characters agree with your viewpoints. Again, if we're going to inspire and heal and challenge things directly against what I think is right, and they do. I know Tremor and Bolt, Tremor is very representational of the traditional black mindset of the whole peaceful protest and, you know, no rioting and things like that. Whereas Bolt, Young Buck, is very much so the mindset of let's crash and break down every window and let them know we're mad, you know? so it's that the older generation versus the newer generation. And they have a lot of falling out because they just don't have the same perspective on how to go about anything at all.
And they hash that out through the story.
Right. They do hash it out through the story. But and then, you know, I think that's the beauty in creating characters with different perspectives as you and different perspectives as each other, because you get to have those moments within the story. You know, if they're riding in the battle, somebody could easily, who doesn't like Obama, say, thanks, Obama. You know how they say it on Facebook. Like, they blame Obama for everything. Thanks, Obama. Whatever. You know, something like taking jabs at each other like we do in real life. You know, things pop out. Your perspective, your beliefs, your values pop out at any given situation, whether it's comedic or whatever. Those things pop out. And it's very important that you pull those things out from your characters. Character development is a very special time to cultivate those things within those characters. They have to have belief systems and different perspectives, and they have to have values and have a sense of navigation within self, you know?
And that right there is why you should not shy away from bringing a collective of different cultures within your own creative team. All of that that had said, bringing on different people with different religious backgrounds, sexual orientation, or what have you, can bring that experience and put that into your story. So don't shy away from that. Bring it on. And if you have a difference in opinion, let the characters hash that out. You know, pull a character like Bolt and then have him go up against, you know, not a physical altercation, but, you know, project that vocally, you know, that kind of debate mentality with someone like Tremor. You know, if you have an argument, well, I believe in this, I believe in that, and the other person's like, well, I believe in this, let's tell that story in our comic.
Right.
Let's project that. So, having a diverse team is very important as well.
Yeah, because we said that when the election came out, we were talking about the election in our Slack chat. Mm-hmm. There were differing opinions. We do a really good job at respecting each other's opinions and not getting all like bent out of shape over politics. But there was a point in there I was like, you know what? Let the characters hash it out, because they also too have different perspectives on this. And they would actually pretty much probably say the same things that we're saying, but let's let them talk about it. And then through them, we can actually kind of see each other's perspective. Because when I'm talking and you're talking, ask each other and through each other. But looking at it from the outside, looking in, looking at these characters talk about it, we can actually sit back and say, okay, well, maybe I was wrong about, maybe my perspective wasn't the best, or maybe my tone wasn't the best in this situation. When you're not actively engaged in that conversation, you can take a step back and evaluate yourself, you know? That's actually one of the, I'm glad you brought that up. That's one of the things I tell everybody, like in their interview. If we ever have a disagreement, you know, values and beliefs on the line, hash it out.
I do remember that question in my interview. I don't remember what I said, but obviously it wasn't bad because here I am. You mean mug me, Yang? I'm going to punch you in the face. You're hired, Tim.
So yeah, this story in particular is your introduction into the Arclight universe. This is like the welcoming mat to a much larger universe, a much larger story. I have been working on this for years. When I brought Brent and Tim on, and Neff and Gabby, you know, whoever else has come on, they have added to the vision of the overarching universe. There's a lot we have to play with. There's a lot we're going to get into over the years. I mean, I've built this out for this to last 15, 20, 25, 30. And one of the things we plan to do, and we're actually, it's very, you have to go about it differently, but because the big two don't do this, but we're actually going to be aging our characters out. Bolt's 18, 19 years old now. There will become a point where he actually turns 45 or 65 in the actual canon, you know, where he becomes an older version of himself. Same with some of the other characters. Every character has an end point that we've introduced so far. And we're working towards that end point for each character as we introduce them, as we put them into the story.
I was going to say, I wish I'd never heard of their end games either. Because I got to say, even though I'm on the spot, I was like, oh, man, I don't want to know that. But Ed is not lying when he says all of our characters and future characters coming out have an end game. There is a plan for literally every cast member and all the other characters we're bringing on. There is an end game for all of them. Mm-hmm. And that story starts with issue 0, the prequel. All the path to that point. Prequel issue is the starting point to get to that end game. Mm-hmm. So there's Easter eggs and everything already planted within the prequel issue that will kind of set the seeds for that plant to kind of grow, you know, by the time, you know, we decide to retire or something.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah, there's a lot of Easter eggs in this issue. A lot. Like in 5 years, come back to the prequel issue, and you'll see certain things that are already connected in here. It's a lot of stuff. Mm-hmm. That one meeting we had, It was like a 4-hour meeting, but we just kept going. Oh, what if we can do this? Oh, let's do this. Let's do that.
So exhausted after that too.
Right. Creative high. We just after that. I was done the whole weekend after that night. But yeah, I mean, they're, the characters have a while to go before they all get phased out.
Maybe.
We're not going to go George R.R. Martin. No, we're not going to go that far. But yeah, it's plan it out. Do yourself a favor. You if you're going to work this much on your stuff, take the time to set the foundation and the structure of everything and plan things out. You know, I mean, it's I guess for me, it is fun. I like doing this stuff. For other people, it may not be so much fun. But if you're the one responsible, if you're the one heading the operation up, if you're leading the charge, your vision or somebody else's vision, you can't have somebody else command and speak over the vision that you have been given at all. That's not how this works. So you either have to just get used to stepping into this role and doing what you have to do, or you have to hand that over to somebody else because it's not going to work. And a lot of times I often see people trying to do the whole, you know, we all have an opinion or whatever. And everybody should have an opinion, but there should be somebody who always has the final say. And everybody should respect that final call. You know, I, of course, am the head honcho in charge, but I always open the floor to Brent, Tim, and Spencer to what they have to say. And usually what they have to say is all valuable stuff. You know, it's like, no, it's going to be done this way. This, don't be a dictator. You open that floor up to allow ideas to come in. And then if they're really good ideas, middle. But you have to have that person in charge to meet in the middle with. Everybody can't be there to meet in the middle. You know, you can't have 20 cooks in the kitchen. That was our downfall with Paradigm Studio. See, I've been through this stuff, so I can tell somebody else what to watch out for. You know, Paradigm Studios was a mess because we had everybody trying to be the boss. Everybody wanted their thing to win, their idea to win. And it won't be like that. It goes back to culture. You have to set the ground rules and have everybody have the same understanding that, you know, your ideas won't always make the cut, but what we do is we use a system called plussing. Now, this system was developed in the early days of Disney, where they would kind of throw ideas around the table. Instead of throwing out an idea, like I say, you know, let's make this color red. And you say, oh, no, that's stupid. Why would we make it red? Well, you just pretty much killed that idea and any traction that would have come from it. Instead, you say, well, let's not make it red because X, Y, and Z. I really like your idea where you're going, but can we maybe try blue because it helps with the story in this, put this in this direction? Like it sets the tone a lot better. Oh, yeah, I see what you're saying. This way. And then what that does is everything kind of snowballs into a much more fluent, much more friendlier, collaborative environment. Tim, I don't think we've ever had like a knockout, drag out argument fight in any of our ideation sessions with story.
No.
Using plussing. Everybody understands that my idea isn't going to make the final cut, but my idea can be a platform for an even better. That's the goal. You know, a plussing.
And that's so fun. It's a very nice rush. When you create that kind of environment, I mean, when you create an environment where everybody is an open door policy where you can throw your idea out there, you know, and not only nobody really says, no, can't do that. I don't like that. That's horrible. You know, right. Like Ed said, we can make it red and then Brent or, you know, I'll come in and say, well, how about we do blue because, you know, the person is sad. And then Brent will come in. Well, psychologically speaking, if we go with purple, he might be sad, but it's right. Very muted or it's a rich color because he's a royal person. You know, everybody goes on the round table and inputs their suggestion, and we build on it like a snowball effect. Starts out with an idea and then becomes something greater that is put into the book or becomes a character. You know,
right.
I have an idea for a character. All right, what's your idea? Let's schedule a pitch. Go through the pitch. Get within that pitch, we'll go on and shoot ideas. Everybody will have their ideas. Like, one thing I will tell you, the major thing you should think about is do not be married to any idea. If you have an idea and you present it to somebody, don't present it to somebody with the expectations of getting kudos. That's not what you're there for. Get the feedback and then allow people to voice their feedback and opinions and possibly even altercations or modifications that can be added to that idea or character or script or a piece of art or colors or whatever. You know, be open enough to hear the voices of your entire team or the person you're presenting this thing to. Ed said it. I've heard him say it several times already. If you're going to give somebody something to give you feedback, do not look for the kudos. Let them tear it up, you know, and then take it and apply it. And that's all there is. If you're on a squad, I keep saying squad. If you're on a team, a collective collaborative, if you will, you have to be open. You have to have your door open for everybody to voice their opinion and then try to find a way to use it in the end of it. Because there was a couple ideas that we've had where we've actually snowballed and spitballed to try to work it up. It's like, you know what? Yeah, that's not the best. But at the same time, we took the time to explore that idea, you know, go over that idea, and loading on top of that and giving suggestions, and at the end it's like, yeah, maybe that doesn't work. And as a team, we're like, yeah, that's not going to work at all. So we go back, we shout out another idea, and then it just keeps going and going and going. Everybody is involved in Arclight Comics, and I really, really hope that if anybody in here is starting up their team or is on a team, that you take that mentality with you. Designate yourself a Kevin Feige, like with Marvel Comics or with Marvel Entertainment, like Ed, you know, is for Arclight Comics. And then allow everybody to voice their opinion, because the bad idea is only one that is not presented. Mm-hmm. Okay, so allow people the chance to voice their ideas, and you could come up with something beautiful from it.
Spencer said in the chat, it's an experience. I tell you what, that first time when you're like in the first, it's your first ideation with Arclight, it's like, what is going on here? Like, what are y'all doing? But it's
yeah,
an interesting process. Yeah.
The only thing I don't like about it is it's not face to face. I mean, they would be so much more enjoyable if we didn't have to be tied down by the limitation of Skype.
Right. No, like when New York Comic Con, we spent like 3 hours outside of the Airbnb where we're staying at, talking. We had like a little impromptu meeting, and that was like wild. It was like we didn't get back in the house like 2:30 in the morning. There was just so many ideas coming out. We were just going back and forth and back and forth. But that's the beauty of a good team. I get this from Gary Vaynerchuk. For those of you who don't know, type in Gary V on YouTube and watch some of his stuff, please. He can be, I don't want to say a little crass. He is very crass. He loves to drop the F-bomb and everything else. But one of my favorite sound bites from him is that you have to start throwing talent at your problems instead of people. Because a lot of people, what they like to do is get 20 people on the team and then have no idea what they want those 20 people to do. That's another thing. If you're going to have a team, if you're going to bring people onto the team, you have to know what they're going to do. How are they directly affecting the success of this project? I remember when you and Neff came on, Tim, I actually had it out there. I pointed, like, I had y'all's names down there. I said, your work directly affects this goal in this way. This is why you're here. This is why your work matters and why I value it so much. You know,
you see that whiteboard behind Ed? That is Arclight stuff. I guarantee it. Probably for our next meeting. No lie.
your project is only going to be as good as your team, and you have to have a solid team. It's very imperative. If you don't have talent on the team, people who are able to let go of their egos, people who are able to work together, people who are able to support and love one another, very often brothers or family, we consider each other a support system outside of our work. There have been times where we have intended to have a meeting, but Brent was going through something very, very bad, or I was going something bad, and we just kind of sat around in Skype and talked through those issues with one another. Because as a leader, you should actually care about what your people are going through day in and out, because first and foremost, that affects their work with the project. If they're not mentally or physically or emotionally all there, there's no point in asking them to do something on that day or throughout that week. Mm-hmm. Simon Sinek says this, that you'll know a good leader if you ask this question. If your boss asks you how your day is going and actually cares about the response, that is a good leader. And when I ask y'all in our meetings, how have, like on a Friday, how have y'all's week been? What has gone on? Is there anything I need to know? But we spent like 45 minutes last meeting going through everybody's week and just kind of detoxing and letting everybody vent and come down from the week first.
That's our open floor session. People,
right. Give everybody that space. Then we're able to go. Once everybody like comes down off that week, the stress and the tension, the frustration of the day job, we're good to go. Like everybody's mentally cleared out. The creativity is there. Everybody's geared up. The energy's high. And we go for like another 2 or 3 hours. Mm-hmm. You know? Exactly.
Yep.
In the chat. So that, again, if you are leading your project, you are tasked with all these responsibilities I'm talking about. And again, if this doesn't sound like fun to you, or if you don't want to do it, you have to step out of that role and give it to somebody else. You have to. Because we have seen so many people try to do this, Tim, and fail, in the sense that they have let the failures of that time completely stop them altogether. We have failed a lot of times. There's a difference between failing and quitting and then failing forward, you know? There's a lesson in the failure. I could easily stop that Paradigm Studios when that fell apart. But I said, okay, too many cooks in the kitchen. You can't have all these people trying to make a comic at once. Take the best men from this project and move forward from it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I just kept doing that. With each new failure, with each new mistake, each new loss, you find the win, you find the success or the lesson in it, and you keep pushing forward. That's how you go about that. You just don't give up at the first sign of trouble.
Yeah.
You can't do that.
Always forward.
Always forward, Luke Cage.
Forward always.
But you know, I see so many people give up on your dreams, and it's like, why?
My dreams. I don't mean to cut you off. I'm sorry, but my dreams is going to be realized in the next page. My all-time dream is to be involved in the making of a comic book. And when I put the final brushstroke on the last page, I'm actually getting choked up a little bit. When I put the final brushstroke on the page, that is a dream realized. Mm-hmm. And if it's that special to me, if you can imagine Ed going through 5, almost 6 years now of trying to get this to happen, mm-hmm. it is very special. And it's all kind of kickstarted with bringing in like-minded individuals. That's all I got to say because, oh my God, am I breakdown such a freak.
I've already been like, there's times where I'll get pages back and I'll either scream or I'll cry. It's very, it's special, you know, when you get to this point where you've worked so hard and you sacrificed so much. And trust me, this is not even like the tip of the iceberg. There's so much more to do. Mm-hmm. We're just getting started. This is not even like, we're still kind of like crawling at this point. We have yet to actually get up and try to walk.
Mm-hmm.
But to make it this far and to see everything play out the way that it's played out, despite everything, it's very rewarding. And you don't put like a dead set. Don't think that you should be accomplishing something in a given amount of time. I'm gonna complete this in 1 year. Tell you right now, that's not going to happen. Not if you're trying to do something like this. It won't happen. Give yourself the space and the time to allow your dream to grow at the rate it needs to grow. You can't rush the process. Trust the process. That was a podcast episode we did. Don't rush your individual process. Trust it. Have faith in it. See the potential in yourself. And if you have given up, give yourself a second chance. You know, children are very resilient. You have an inner child in you somewhere still living. Let that child out and be hopeful that you will get to the finish line eventually. If you like five of our characters.
You see how I did that? I got it. Yep.
I swear we don't play around. We thought about that back in like 2011 or 2012. Like every character should have a theme. I just gave you like five. Faith, Tremor, Inner Child is Riot. Second Chances is Braxton. Potential is Go Girl. Who am I missing? Bold is Truth. Solace is Hope. We haven't introduced him yet. Apex is Family. We have another one that we're actually working on. We haven't developed her theme yet, but that's actually one of the courses we'll be working on very soon. It's called, I hate the name of it today. It's called Unleash the Soul. It's discovering the soul of your characters. And we actually take you through our character development and story process of how we develop our own characters. And it always starts with theme. And then we reverse engineer backwards the theme into origin and backstory and powers and how all that supports the theme. So it's going to be a video course. Very intense stuff. We actually been working on it for like about a year now, the content and refining that formula over and over. Like when we first came out with it, it had like 20 different steps. It was a beast. And then now we have it down to like five main points that are very refined and will take you through our character development process and how we build our own character. So you can do the same thing, because I was talking to my coworker Friday about how we kind of reverse engineered how Marvel and DC go about branding and marketing their own characters. And you have to look at what Marvel's doing right now with their characters. DC has more of that iconic element where there's three major things that they use. Color, iconography, and silhouette. We actually have a free course coming out next year, beginning of next year, on these three things. Heads up for that. And for your characters is to be able to break them down into their simplest form. And if you go Toys R Us or Spencer's or Walmart or whatever, you'll see Captain America as a toy, as a hat, as a hoodie, as a slipper, as a pair of underwear, socks, whatever. That character is represented in those three things: his silhouette, his colors, and his iconography. Same with Superman and Batman and Wonder Woman, things like that. If you look at what Marvel's doing right now with the release of Black Panther and Doctor Strange and Ant-Man, because Marvel doesn't really have a lot of iconography embedded into their characters, they're having to go back now and develop that iconography for them. I mean, Iron Man is represented by his helmet. Thor is represented by his hammer. Hulk by his fist. You have Black Panther. It's the Panther outline. Doctor Strange is the most recent one. We point this out at New York Comic Con. It's the Eye of Agamotto, that pattern, that whatever. They try to extract iconography out of Doctor Strange. It's very hard for a character like that, but they managed to do it. You do that, so when you go into merchandising and when you go into branding and marketing, you are able to dismantle your character and still have that character recognizable on no matter what you put them on. You know, another element in there. that helps with recognizability and memorability. But those are like the three main things. And that's also in our course. I'm actually going to teach that in that course I just talked about. How do you go about, first of all, taking the theme and the story and the origin or whatever of that character and translating that into the actual design? Because we've been doing that with Solace and Apex. We did it with another character that's we're no longer using or whatever, but then I'm with Tremor and Bolt and Go-Go and everything else as well. So there's a process to that. So when your character gets spit out on the other end, since he's here, Darren was the one that put this in my head. I'm going to share what Darren shared with me a couple years back when I showed him our lineup back then. He said, I let him like have a sneak peek of all the characters or whatever. He said, you know, Tremor is still like pretty much the only one that actually looks really, really good. And he said, when you look across the room and you see the color palette and you see a silhouette and you see, you know, all the things on his design, you can say to yourself, yeah, okay, that's Tremor. I get it. Same with Spider-Man. When you look across the room, you see the webbing in his suit, the spider symbol and everything else, his silhouette, how he's posed out. Spider-Man. He said, when I look at your other characters, I don't quite get things. There's something not being communicated. There's something being miscommunicated here, you know? And I had to take a step back at what he had said and say, I can see that. I really can. Because we have this character named Riot, and he's like this, dressed as this Buddhist monk, and the name doesn't quite with what he looks like and you know, whatever else. So that was like one of the really great foundations of what kickstarted a lot of the redesigns for a lot of our characters and what we still use to this day. When you look across the room, when you look at Go-Girl or Braxton or Bolt, you should be able to say, yeah, that makes sense as to why that character is named the way they are named, you know. It's 11 o'clock. I did not realize that.
We're only planning this for like an hour.
Right.
We're going to call it at about the hour mark.
Right. We're almost at the but it's right. Right. Is anybody in the chat have any like questions or like, are you still with us? I pretty much stopped lettering. I'm going to pick it back up and work a couple more hours once we're done here. I'm just a finalized.
Yeah, I'm finishing my last couple pages tonight.
Nice. This is a really good issue.
Yes, it is.
I try not to be biased or whatever. But we worked really hard, you know, to make this happen. I'm very proud of the team. If you're still in the chat, that's not the link I wanted to pull up. I'm going to post the link. You can actually pre-order issue 0 right now. There will be a time in the day where I don't have to sit here and type the link, copy the link, paste the link, put it in here. We're actually going to further develop our chat for the community that we have. There's a new chat system called Community Talk coming out by Sean West. Phenomenal chat system where we'll be able to do live broadcasts like this, webinars, and it has its own dedicated chat system. You know, it'll be, I cannot wait. Yeah, a lot of our life experiences are in. Tim, how many times have we cried during character pitch sessions? God,
almost all of them so far.
Thanks, Darren. Yeah, a lot of our life experiences, that's actually part of our development process. I don't know if I'm giving too much away right now, but it's very important that you take something from your life and embedded into that character, because dynamic, and we're very complex as human beings. And you have to get that same complexity and dimension in your characters. And one of the best ways we found how to do that is to take your own life experiences, not only the good ones, but the ones that you tend to not want to remember, or the ones that make you, or rather get you emotionally drained, or make you feel some type of way, because that's what makes us interesting as people. You know, not had a perfect life where we've escaped trauma and drama and tragedy and whatnot else. We've all gone through something. So why not use that as a platform, or not a platform, but a resource to build off for your character? I mean, Tim's pitch, I had to grab my tissues for Apex, and then Brent's pitch for Solace, I had to grab my tissues. I mean, it was like, oh my god, y'all, I'm looking for the upswing. Like, y'all got to bring us up out of this. Give me something on a hot topic. But Spencer said Tim's pitch made him cry too. We do bring a lot of our life experiences and pull those into our characters, because that's what makes them so three-dimensional. They have so much depth. Each other. And then that gives you a lot of storytelling possibility. It gives you a lot of story to play with in the actual comics. You know, I always said your characters have to do more than save the day every single issue. What else are they doing outside of being a superhero? You have to kind of look at it as, these are people who happen to have superpowers. But you have to create the person first and then give them the superpowers. If you do it the backwards way, then you're relying on the extraordinary part. There's a balance there. You have to have the ordinary and the extraordinary, and they have to do a dance with your characters. We have to see them in their ordinary moments so we can relate. Then we have to see them in their extraordinary moments as something to aspire to become, or you know, like Superman or Batman or Wonder Woman. You know, we idolize these characters, but at the same time, they have those moments where they're human. It's in further. That's why we're sticking around for 75 plus years for all these characters. There's always an issue. Thank you, Lena.
I actually was just checking on that myself. Oh, gosh. Business, Ed. There's always something.
This is why I want somebody to, I want a web developer to come in and just knock all this stuff out. I don't ever want to touch this stuff. I would rather not. You know, I thought I thoroughly tested the page. Clearly not. Gosh.
Yeah, I mean, you and your team can be the best source of adding the human component to your characters.
Right. I just clicked it. Hold on. I just clicked the top link.
Yeah, it actually took me to the checkout now.
Yeah.
Are you overseas, Lena? We are in a delay. Gosh, I hate the delay.
I hate delay too.
It's actually really good. See, testing out now.
Darren actually said the best Superman stories was when he was being an empathetic man, not being super.
Like, you know what's funny? Oh, gosh. Sorry.
She's in New Zealand.
There's a Superman story. Yeah, maybe it could be an overseas thing, Ed.
Maybe.
Wayne McDuffie wrote a Superman story. It's very popular. Of course, it's going to slip my mind right now. The Last Son? All-Star Superman. That was the human. We're seeing. I don't know if anybody's going to read it, or spoiler alert, but pretty much what Darren just suggested, the best Superman stories, because you have a character that is, in all intents and purposes, a god. But when you bring him down to the level of humanity, that's when the interesting stuff happens. Mm-hmm. So when you have a character that can literally fly through the planet, the most interesting things come from, you know, when he comes more to Earth and stuff like that. And that's another thing. Creating a character that can blow up suns and all that stuff while at the same time being able to hold on to 8 machine guns because it sounds cool. You know, you got to be practical with your designs as well. Right. You know, you can't have a guy that flies through busting up stars and saving planets, and he's the reason. Oh, I was about to call somebody out. I'm glad I stopped. Oh, boy. I'm like, hit my top right there.
Now, that's a great point, Tim, because, I mean, Tremor, for instance, Earth, Terra Kinetic, can move mountains. He also lives in Chicago, Illinois. Somebody like him, hopefully I'm not giving too much away, but he is very reserved on how he uses his power because he knows that he can't set off an earthquake right in the middle of Chicago without killing a bunch of people. He just can't rip up the street because that's infrastructural damage he's causing to the city. Somebody's going to have to pay for that. Very limited and how he uses his power. In the middle of a desert, sure, tear it up. But if we're in a city, he just can't go ballistic. He can't go crazy because a lot of people are in danger. He has to have a reserve. He has to be cognizant that, hey, we have to clear the area by this many miles for me to do anything this big, you know? And that's where the humanity starts kicking in. It's like, you know, in that moment, if the earthquake is going to save a million people, but by doing it, you kill 1,000, which one do you choose? You know? And then how do you live with the decision that you've made after it? So somebody asked a question with characters. I realize Marvel and DC don't rely on faces to tell the story, hence mask. It's all about movement, action. How do you balance this to show emotion? You want to take it?
I'm reading the question again right now. So with the characters, I realize Marvel and DC don't rely on faces to tell the story, hence masks. It's all about movement and action. How do you balance this to show it? With action beats, you know, you can do your story-driven moment and then come follow it with an action beat. Whether they have a mask on or not, you can. There is always some way to invoke emotion, whether it's with the artwork with Miguel. That when Miguel does his artwork, he can invoke emotion in the way the browser. Because I'm not really sure what the question is asking, so I'm actually just going to cover everything. So you can show with your brow. You know, you can show it in the art itself. You can show it in the colors by the tone that you color in. You know, even leaving it very monotone or very washed. You know, to show a very heavy moment. Rain is another. You know, the precipitation itself can be a mood setting. And then you can hit it home with your text in the narration boxes, because comic books is a very visual medium. Because if you can't tell it with the art, you can hit it home with the narration chat. Action, but yeah, I mean, comics for the most part, they're all full on Michael Bay stuff. You know, it's almost to a point where it's all about the action and stuff, and it. At the same time, just like we said before, if you're writing a comic and all you want is action, 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 you're going to give someone, okay, that's you're playing in a sandbox. You know, you can only play in a sandbox too long before you want to move over to the monkey bars, you know, because you might enjoy playing in that particular action beat, but you also need to change it up. Too much of one thing can almost be damning. So you can break it up with very character-driven moments and stuff like that. So you, if it's very action-heavy, it's probably best to spread out your action beats a little bit more just to give the readers a break from that. With Arclight Comics, it's, okay, what story do we want to tell? We land on which story, because I'm trying to think before I say stuff because I don't want to give anything away whatsoever. But we land on a specific story we want to tell. And then it's funny because action is that never really gets brought up. It's a secondary thing for us. There is a lot of action and there is a lot of visual eye candy in our book. But the story comes first. Story is king. There you go. You. Story is king. So focus on the story first. And then everything else just kind of falls in line.
Always focus on the story. Story, if there's action, if people are fighting, what is the reason for this fight to break out? Story will drive it should drive every single decision, cause and effect in that narrative. All the time. But you show them up because a lot of our characters don't wear masks. I don't think we draw them in such like their faces that are expressive. But, you know, like Tim said, comics is very visual. And your art and the lettering, there's a dance there. One of them has to lead. They both can't be leading at the same time. You know, if your character is sad, they don't say, "I'm sad" in the dialogue box. We can see that they're sad. So if in the illustration, if we see that your character is somber or something like that, in the caption box or in the dialogue, support the lead dancer. The lead dancer is the art. So you the narration, the story should be supporting what's going on there. You know, I think on one of those pages I showed earlier, we originally didn't have any dialogue on that page whatsoever. And then I said, well, I can support what's going on with some additional context and give it some more flavor. But the art is leading the narrative here. What I'm adding with the dialogue and any narration captions or whatever is just going to accent what's already going on. So it can go both ways. Either the text can lead in the dance and the art is the supporting, or the art is going to lead and then the text is supporting. But they both can't lead. You know, I think, what is it, Tango, Foxtrot, or whatever, somebody leads and the other person has to follow. Both people can't lead, otherwise you can't do the dance. But that's what it is. It's a dance between the two. So play with that. In order to, you know, to express emotion and things like that through your characters in the story. Yeah. Because, I mean, all these pages, you can clearly see what's going on. You don't need any text. If we really wanted to, you can kind of release this whole book without any supporting text. Mm-hmm.
And you can come up with you can come up with a story through the art. Right. Like, that's one of the gifts Miguel has. That is a gift. I almost say a gift. I almost think a gift is probably demeaning to what Miguel is. That's skills that he's developed. You know, that's
it.
In the art and story world, there is no such thing as talent. A lot of people actually take offense when you say, "Oh, you're so talented." Mm-hmm. The rule of 1000. You know, long ago, before I even got on Arclight, I think Ed would post every now and then, just wrote 10,000 words or did 12,000 words or something like that. Maybe I was on the team. I think I was on the team at the time. It's like, what the hell's wrong with you? But then I reflect back. I would draw literally thousands of eyeballs, thousands of noses, thousands of single fingers. You know, it's the rule of 1,000. Repetitive in building your skill up. So Miguel has developed this skill over time to be able to tell a story from page to page and panel to panel. So if you can do that, you know, regardless if they're wearing a mask or not, like for Black Panther, Deadpool, all right, how they play with his eyes and brow movement and stuff like that. You can see even Spider-Man does the same thing. You can see the emotion and the context of that particular panel within that facial structure. I mean, one day we might have a full mask character. I don't know. Who knows?
We do. His name is Ride, and nobody ever draws.
Nobody ever. I remember you bringing that up. I even did production art. I think I've done two so far. So I did something for a super secret top project that I think we put on the shelf for now. And then I did the production art or the character art, and both of them have, because I thought it was like a scarf kind of thing, but no, it's. No idea. No idea.
Parkour fanatic. Yeah, we actually talked about that in our meeting. We had to adjust some of the design details of some of the characters. We actually launched them in the the first graphic novel. Actually, that's what we're actually going to be approaching our distribution as, graphic novels. I personally, if it's an indie, even if it's indie or if it's mainstream, if it's a new title or from being reintroduced to a character through a new book or something, I don't want the 20-page story. I give me the whole trade paperback. Give me the whole collection of this arc in one sitting, because I don't want to have to digest the story month after month. I feel like that just disrupts the narrative. I thought it would be best if we gave everybody the story all at once and let them digest it and get through it as they please. If you want to read 22 pages that day, you can come back the next day and read 30 if you wanted to, you know? So we will be distributing in the form of graphic novels versus your traditional floppies.
Arclight and Shield. So, no.
Right. So it's going to take us a little longer to get things out, but we already got the ball rolling for what we're calling book one. It doesn't have a title yet. We're calling book one, book two, whatever. In that first overarching arc. And they're going to be, you know, 10 years from now, if you want to tell somebody, if somebody asks you, where do you get started with the Arclight universe? So, well, first you can go back to issue zero, the passing. That's like your primer. Then you want to jump into books one through three, published in, I don't know, 2018. That's how long that arc ran. We have like a system all, we've worked on this stuff all behind the scenes. I can't say too much, but it's all there, you know, how we're building the system on the back end for how we're going to name the books and how we're going to be called and whatnot else.
Comicsology. Mythology.
Yeah. The process takes so long.
That was interesting to learn.
Submit as soon as we're finished here, which should be by like the end of the week.
We ain't going to wait for their process, though, I'll tell you that much.
Right. Yeah, it'll be available when we're done. If you want to know Comicsology, of course, you have to wait. But there will be, it will be in a PDF format and a CBR format. I think you can drag and drop a CBR format into your comics. I've done that before. If I bought something that was a CBR outside of Comicsology, I would just plug in my tablet or my phone, drop it in the folder, and it would pick it up on Comicsology. I can read it through there or whatever. But yeah, I have not eaten since breakfast. Again, I don't know why I do this. I guess the live streams make me like panic and I don't eat anything. And then right at like the tail end of the thing, it hits me that I have
the same thing for the meetings too.
Right. I haven't eaten all day.
So guys, this is not going to take too long. I haven't eaten yet. And then 3 hours later. It's funny because almost every meeting starts out with, how y'all doing? How's your day? You only got this to talk about. I don't want to take forever to go over this. You know, it's only going to be about an hour. And then 3 hours later, you know, we're still there.
Right. It's crazy, but we have a lot of fun. I have to say, we have a lot of fun at Arclight. It's a ball. I love working with Tim and Brent and Spence. I am very thankful for this team. It is an incredible team. We do a lot. We're pulling back on a lot for 2017. Again, we're not doing the podcast next year. Don't have the time. Don't have the space for it. We are also pulling back on a lot of other things. A lot of our output is going to stop for probably the first quarter of the year. I mean, if you've been following us, we do Instagram, we do Facebook, we do blogs, we do podcasts, we do these things right here. I used to do Arclight TV. We do mini issues. We did a lot in 2016. We have a lot done.
You can also apply to our community, yo. You're not right. Even already. It's still in beta, though. It's not open yet.
Right. Still in beta. We're still building up the membership. Again, let me give them the link. People get help in there. It's the quickest way to get access to us. I know people send us like Instagram messages or Facebook messages, and I don't always respond, but we're always inside the community because Slack is our main form of communication. And it's just a click away to get into the community for us. So we jump right over to the community whenever there's questions or where we can chime in or help. We will offer that up. It comes, you know, outside the community, we would charge. Mm-hmm. If you want a critique on your script, it's gonna cost money. But inside the community, it's like, this is you're paying for this membership. You're paying for access to not only myself and my team as well, and the other community members that are in there, because we're not the only ones with skills or whatever. There are other people, very talented people inside the community. We have illustrators, other storytellers, somebody else who is also writing their mini issues, who was inspired by our mini issues. There's like, you know, I was trying to write a novel and I got, then heard about the mini issues in the podcast. I was like, oh, this is a good idea. He showed us his mini issue, and it is incredibly well done. So that was a pleasant surprise. But we have all types of people in there that are just equally talented and great pool of people so far. So if you feel like the community would be something for you, I just dropped the link in the chat over here. It's also arclightcomics.com/community for those listening back on the replay. About an application, don't think so much about the price. Don't worry about that. So that's your first step. Fill out the application and do that. So I have to get food so I can like finish
scarf. The
lettering. I have to finish. Yeah. So much, Tim. We do. Oh, boy, this was actually fun. I actually would like to do more of these next year.
It was a lot of fun.
Yeah. I imagine having Brent and Spencer, whoever else we may bring onto the team in 2017.
I kept going off about, you know, getting that the preach mode. And that's actually when I turned my tablet off and I turned the webcam on me. I was like, all right, it's going to be one of those. Yeah, it was a lot of fun.
Right.
Thanks a lot, Spencer. I appreciate it, bud.
I appreciate everybody who came, even if you just poked your head in. We had more people than we did last time. We had 4 last time. And we had 9. This, I think 10.
Yeah, it was up to 10. It was very surprising.
Yeah. Yeah. So, and you see how excited we are? For 10 people.
Appreciate all y'all, though.
Yeah, this comes with some humility as well. You know, again, like I said in the last one we did, if you can't perform and give the same energy and give the same time and the same amount of all in front of 4 people, you won't be blessed with the 400 or the 4,000. You know, you have to perform and go all in with what you are given. I appreciate everybody who showed up here tonight, you know, whether it be 5, 50, 500 or 5,000. I appreciate these people very, very much, because nobody could have shut up. Even if nobody shut up, we still would have been on here having a ball.
Oh, yeah. So, no doubt.
Right. So thank y'all so much for tuning in. We will be back in 2017. Hopefully we'll do more of these, and go ahead and pre-order issue 0. It is going to be phenomenal. I can't wait to get in everybody's hands. So thank you.
Have a good one, y'all.
Bye. Now I have to open the chat up and take forever to close the broadcast. Bye.